draw. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Dragon Shire. We're in the grand finals.
That's Texas, if I've ever heard. It's high noon.
It's high noon, somewhere in the world. I can't remember who, Killian Experience, very funny YouTuber. He basically did a rundown of all the Overwatch heroes. And he was like, this is McCree. He's a cowboy. Cowboys haven't been cool in years. Looks like a fun hero to play, but unfortunately he has something called chronodysplasia, where he's unable to tell time, and I don't want to play a hero with mental issues.
Nice. That sounds funny.
It's a funny episode. Funny video. Like, he did a... when it came to Pharah, and he was like, Pharah, in Overwatch's rock-paper-scissors balancing, Pharah is a pickaxe.
Is that good?
Very good. Yeah, I apparently.
You can probably beat all
like,
that.
Everyone's like, oh, I think maybe this would be counter. No. Pharah is counter. Watch me.
How's his Tassadar?
Tassadar is counter to everything. Yeah, Tassadar is this game's Pharah. Tass is counter. Watch me. But it is going to be banned out first here by a team at Gangang.
More, considering that second ban, is it going to be Arthas, Anurag, Dahaka, or Falstad, or Malph? One of those five. If it's not, I'm going to shave the sides of my hair.
How'd you do that, chat? Keep track.
Well, luckily I already do it.
Yeah. Do it more. You need to do them bald. Just as close as possible.
Phew! It's one of the five.
It's Falstad. It's all good. But what remains of the side of your hair is safe.
Nice.
Arthas, first pick for Gangang.
Gold, blue. It reminds me of a Monty Python episode. Blue, no, green? Yellow!
Red, no, green. Ah! Or in this case, blue, green, as he swaps between.
Wasn't he going blue and yellow?
No, it was green. That skin doesn't have a yellow one.
This
it's
is
red,
blue.
Blue, and green.
No, it was just, I was pretty sure it was just on yellow.
No. Arthas only has green. That particular skin for Arthas only has green, blue, red.
Let's see what it's called in 2.0, okay, Tetsu? I'm sure it has some obscure name.
I'm sure it does, but we'll have to Google
like
it. Just
Golden
research.
Morning Sun, Arthas, or.
There's only two different ways that color is described like that, and that is hero skins and car paint colors. Just like you will have a red car, and it's like, no, it's sunrise orange. According to your manual.
Expensive names for expensive toys.
Indeed.
Nazebo bringing
out first pick.
The left field strategies. Nazebo in first pick. It's not something we've seen today. Dragonshire games do tend to have the capability to go long. There's a generic statement if I've ever heard one, but it's possible.
Yeah. So we actually see Gangang have been able to pick up both Arthas and Anubarak in the first phase here, and also have got their hands on Greymane. Very decent job by them.
The speed of their pick showed that they feel that Ma has really dropped the ball here. Or
yeah.
The soap, as it were. And
They super wanted these heroes.
Yeah, there was no doubt. It's like, oh, you got Nazebo? Okay, we take the best two warriors in the game and the best ranged assassin in the game.
Lucio, banned out, considering between Dahaka or Valor here.
Could go the good old Jimmy and Takis. Double Marine action.
This is Jimmy. You ain't feeling effective. But we haven't seen him in a while. Actually, we have seen him every now and again. Just very varying results.
He's probably my favorite hero when I get down to it. My favorite ranged hero, anyway. Yeah. One of my favorite. He's so deep, you know?
He's got so many mechanics.
Yeah, I think you don't get him. That's why you're being sarcastic about this.
You clearly don't understand all of the skillful moves that you can pull off on easy. I mean, Hyperion, highest skill ability in the game.
I mean, it depends a lot how you angle it. Like
yeah,
you can
I mean,
actually
you
predict.
You have to stand a certain distance away from the keep to get the maximum amount of damage on it.
Look, right, I stroke the R button when I cast Hyperion. I don't press it.
It's a delicate ability. You have to be delicate with it.
Do you want a Hyperion on the right target or not?
Fair enough. So we're having Johanna and Vala coming in here for more.
I bet
so they
you
have
just Hyperion
the
first thing inside, Titch. Yes. Rhaegar, go on.
Rhaegar to add food to Greymane, so they now both teams have supports. Gangang need the second damage dealer unless they want to just put full protection onto Greymane. Taking their time on it. Who do you think would work? Gael'thas banned.
Oh.
Gael'thas again, second time.
Well, that works.
Yeah, well, works fine. No complaints.
They could have taken anything, really. Mm-hmm. Ooh.
Yorok and Gael'thas, second game in a row. Haven't seen them basically all day, and then they turn up two in a row.
Yeah. And Johanna Leoric won a very easy game yesterday on Hero League against Johanna Leoric, but that's because we had a single warrior, and it really begged the question, why do you take Leoric against a single warrior? But in this case, makes a little bit more sense. Leoric, very good against Arthas. It's good on Dragonshire. They still needed a solo laner. You can't put Nazebo there, but it's not ideal. And so the pieces of the chess table have been set. Let's see which side will win, red or blue.
A half-hearted attempt at portrait synergy by Moore. Only two Lily portraits.
Ooh, a bit of a misplay there.
Yeah, anti-hero with the best hero with the best portrait.
At this level, disappointing, really, that you don't get the full Lily action. Yeah.
Clearly, you don't synergize as a team. The team will break up in a couple months if you don't have that portrait synergy.
There's still enough time. I believe you get three chances to get a full Lily combination.
But it doesn't have to be Lily. It can be just be any hero. But obviously, the worse the hero, the better your synergy.
Yeah, I forgot that non-existing rule of this hypothetical mechanic. Here in the left, in the blue, Team Moa, completely from Sweden. It's going to be Siku on Leoric, Suris on Vala, Ruskme on Johanna, Won on Malfurion, and Knuti on Nazebo.
And falling on the right, hand side, it is going to be Team Gangang. Name for them, it is going to be Arthas, played by Antihero, BKB on the Anubarak, Zay3 on Kael'thas, Raid Boss on Greymane, and Kronaz playing the Rhaegar. And that's the first time I've seen a team rushed at the mid tower.
Yeah.
They don't admit it. But they do rush it. Yeah. Then they have to get a tiny bit of damage. And once again, the lovely Nazebo minion block. Nice move there.
Cool strats here. Backdooring the bottom lane as they make their mid lane more difficult to reach.
Yeah. Very nice move there. And the rotation's happening pretty aggressively. It's going to be Greymane versus Leoric in the top lane. Interesting matchup, similar to the Sonya versus Leoric matchup, in the fact that Greymane can win just by out-damaging Leoric's healing.
Yeah, easy to get away as well from the drain lives. He has the ranged advantage. Knuti!
Root on Knuti. This follow-up stun does not land, though, and he begins to walk away. Kael'thas is on point, though, and the Feral Lunge will finish off the kill.
Uh-oh, he just used... disengage.
Mistakes, but good god does he do damage, but he will get a kill! Wow, value! What a play!
Okay.
I mean, he was gonna die, that was really nicely done. Well played, Raid Boss.
Yep, that's some rank 11 Grandmaster material there.
Yeah, good job indeed. And that's gonna allow Leoric, however, to grab control of the top shrine and prevent both of them going over to Gangang for the moment. Antihero finally rotating back down as Greymane returns to the top lane.
Yeah, please do this, guys. If you lose your solo laner in any game, rotate safely to that lane, soak the experience. The death itself usually isn't the main problem. It's the complete unwillingness to rotate of random teammates to cover a lane of XP. It's like, get that wave. It's going to clash on the tower. It's very important. You see all the best players and teams making those adjustments instantly. You don't need to stay there forever. And I think that's probably part of the fear of randoms. Is they're like, once they're in that solo lane, they're afraid they'll never leave again.
They're afraid that this solo laner will be like, oh, well, they've got the solo lane now. I don't need to be there. And they'll just go somewhere else.
Like a pass me down.
I don't know why the solo lane's the best place to be. I love the solo lane.
Yeah, I like it. I mean, not if I'm Lucio, but, you know.
No, yeah, obviously hero matters in that. But I love being the hero who gets control of the solo lane.
But that was
or
a good
the
move.
Tank.
That was a good move by Antihero. Gets a bit of that XP, leaves again. It's how it should be done. Very educational.
EKB, the aggressive Burrow, getting a little bit of damage in, but takes a couple zombies for his trouble. And just a nice little duel between Raid Boss and Nuti up in this top lane.
Yeah, I kind of find this, you know, this 1v1 lane almost more interesting than the 4v4. There's so many nuances. Like, yeah. Does your character have a teleport or a dash that you can use to get in and out of the shrine? Oh, nicely done by Anubarak. Delaying with BKB, well done. Delaying the 1v3, not dying, and then bro charging away. Secured the Dragonite.
Was still weird, though. Sirius could have absolutely interrupted that if he was paying attention. Instead, he pulled all the way back to his towers, not knowing where the rest of the heroes were. But if he'd been able to scout a bush somehow with maybe one of his abilities, he could have easily interrupted with auto attacks.
But it's a good point. He did not know, right? Because there was a two-man bruiser cap.
Zeku dropping low, living bomb, one cocktail. More cocktail! Oh,
slightly
so close.
Misangled, just a tad.
Yeah, in the meantime, Dragonite was able to take down the mid wall and is finally popped up for his top lane. The push has started there, the three-man push in the top lane, able to grab one more tower.
Yeah, they're
going to get the other one thanks to the wizard.
About as much advantage as you could hope to get, I think, from the Dragonite. Four towers, very good result. Bruiser Camp still persisting. And the value of that Bruiser Camp, mostly, it's time. Now, it's possible you don't use that time and just stand around doing nothing. But they are absolutely doing so. They know three members of Maw still in the top. And it allows them to steal the Siege Camp. Maximum value from such a distraction.
Doing a good job here, Gangang. Taking quite a lot of control over this game for the moment. Malfurion going to have to spend some time clearing this up. Isn't that Moonburn going to take a while, requiring the assistance of his team?
Yeah. Yeah, and when Malf is always together with allies, Moonburn probably does less wave clear than the Innervate talent, if you take it, because you can just empower your teammates to wave clear better. And he is pretty much always going to be with the team here, but in this case he gets Scouting Drone to detect ganks. In the meantime, the Zeebo gets mercilessly mauled by the double doggy action of Raid Boss and Kronas. And their compadres, Z3 anti-hero on Kael'thas and Arthas.
Kronas wanted to get some value out of his lightning bomb there. Unfortunately, it was Raid Boss who was tanking the keep, so as such, he had to pull back into range. So the lightning bomb did not get the value that they were looking for.
Wow, look at this. How many camps can
the
you be stealing?
Audacity of this team.
Utter
it's working
audacity.
For him very well.
How dare you?
How
level
dare?
10.
they have level 10, that makes sense.
The Bridge of Death!
A four-man move onto the Bridge of Death, but they have full vision of the enemy team in the bot lane. It's just going to be Nuti chucking spiders and frogs, and in this case, Gingerbread Man.
Well, still pretty good value from the Bridge of Death. Getting Arthas down to 10% 1v4 is not a bad result by Nazebo.
Yeah, Graham, by the way, holding his heroic. The Cursed Bullet would have two tanks could gain value on. Drop the Throat would be decent for the Zeebo, but then again, you don't know if he's going to go for Superstition to lower the value or Icebox just to deny it completely.
Yeah, true. It would leave the target's mouth and Vala. Still pretty compelling, but he will go for Cursed Bullet.
He does. Vala, by the way, going in with the Creed of the Hunter, getting that extra attack damage.
Yeah, Vala's auto attack build is just the best from the three. But you only take it if you feel like you can safely auto-attack plenty of frontline targets. You don't take it against mages generally, not with that idea in mind at least. And so after Anubarak bro charges in, if you dodge it, and Arthas himself, both can be fairly easily attacked from range. Especially once you get level 20, so I think that's a really good choice for this matchup.
Yep. It is the best if you're in a situation where you can get maximum value out of it.
Right. Of course, sometimes you might want map-specific talents to deal with some kind of PvE, but in terms of teamfight, it does the most damage.
Indeed, Zeku pulling back. Wave going to be cleared very quickly by Rhaegar and Greymane. Lyric is found. Phoenix dropped even to try and guarantee the kill, and they do get it. Nicely done. Once again, we're seeing Gangang with currently 4-1.
Yeah, very nicely done. They're really on point here. This team that has not had a scrim together with their full lineup here, with newest member Z3, who plays a wide variety of heroes. Mages, Medivh, Falsa, Tassadar. Doing pretty nice here on Kael'thas. I thought he was casting Pyro Blast for a second, but he was just mounting up.
Yeah, same animation. That's a next level bait. We're seeing BKB having to back up for now as the Gargantuan was beating him good in Tomb, though. Anti-Ancestral does not land. He gets picked off. And we see everyone else from Gangang pulling back, and as such, bottom shrine will be taken by Moa, as they're going to be able to try and gain back some map control, even though they are still a level behind.
Very well done. Very needed as well. Had they not got that kill, they would have been looking at a level 13 deficit. And now they have the ability to kind of close in. They want this game to last long. Valak gets 40% bonus range at level 20. And Nazebo, a million extra damage.
Literally a million. He's not even underestimating there. Raid boss getting drained. Ancestral this time landing. And as such, Raid boss able to pull back. And Nazebo being sneaky. Able to sneak this for more. But in comes Antihero. And they just pass like ships in the night.
Hello.
A little bit of a drain, try to annoy Antihero as much as possible. Here comes the rest of Gangang, and Ziku's like, I remember this situation. The zombie wall, though, preventing it, but they're not done. They want it, he's not mounted up because he dropped the zombie wall. The entomb is good, but Rainboss leaps the wall. And as such, they guarantee themselves another kill. But in this time, the rest of Moa rotated down to bot lane and were able to grab control of that altar. If they had been willing to take the risk, they could have actually left someone mid and probably actually captured the Dragonite. Yeah. That would have been super risky.
Yeah, it's like, oh, we can get these kills here with just three of us. Yeah, definitely a risky endeavor. But
sorry to interrupt. Living Bomb Kael'thas build.
Oh, wow.
It happened. Okay. It's a thing. It's real. Oh. I'm not crazy. He's taking damage as he goes in. Cursed Bullet. Chunking a little bit of Rask there, but he's able to sustain for it.
Wow. I never thought I would see it today.
Yeah, it's not even with the extra radius. He is just going to try to spam it with Pyromaniac.
Yeah, that's true.
Interesting.
Well,
cool.
You know what Justin Bieber said?
Never
say never.
Okay, I was wondering where you were going with that. Because he said a lot of bad
I don't things. Think there was any way to go where really it's acceptable what I was saying.
No, you referenced Justin Bieber, so mistakes were made. Rask taking a big chunk of damage. Good knock up by PKB. He's out of mana though, so he's not going to have a way out of this. Having to back Ancestral's beautifully done there. And we're going to see Gangang able to recapture the objective there.
Damn, that was a knife's edge Ancestral healing. This time hitting it. Oh, max range, gravity lapse.
Yeah.
Just about missing. Nazebo getting a camp. He's a specialist after all. I still remember someone once told me, you're a specialist, why aren't you getting any camps? Well, you know, Nazebo isn't particularly good at it, unless he casts Gargantuan. No,
pretty much he's getting chunks quite a bit here. Ziku in a familiar situation, getting himself getting killed off here by the roaming gank squad of Team Gangang. Who, can we call him Team Gangang? Is that the next one?
No, I think it's Gangang.
Ah, sad times.
We need that extra G to merit such a pronunciation.
This fair Antihero taking a little bit of damage to the Gargantuan is going to delay this objective for quite a long time, and that gives time for the three man to rotate to bot, and they will be able to take that ultra back and prevent the Dragonite from being taken.
Gargantuan has 92% of the HP of Arthas, roughly. It's pretty much like a tank.
Pretty decent, and it's not a hero, so technically Giant Killer won't affect it.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah, but has no armor too.
Yes, that is fair. We're seeing Mort attempting to gain some XP here by pushing in the mid lane. They instead find a Nubarak to the face, but they are able to take down the tower.
Game is going longer and longer. Level 20 is going to become a very realistic possibility as 11 out of 12 forts are still up. And Nazebo is such a threat in late game. This could be looking good. You could see, okay, levels, but I think Ma is ahead. Having made it to this point with Nazebo and Leoric Spectral Leech.
Ooh. Oh my god, Ziku. Oh, thank god, Nazebo saving saving Ziku for some embarrassment there.
Yep. He does not have Skeletal Reach. Chose Lingering Apparition. Maybe he plays a lot with Skeletal Reach.
Possibly Lingering Apparition. Very good for escaping when you're engaged upon. You used to see it taken with the armor. That hasn't been the build for quite a while. Kael'thas still going with the Fury of the Sunwell at level 5. There, I believe there's a living mob build there.
Maybe he just misclicked his level 7.
Maybe he did. Who knows?
Honestly, I think he did. He plays so many different heroes. I don't really think it makes sense to play like this. Especially not taking the radius at
Yeah, he did. Okay, so he didn't take the radius. So he gets... And there's twin spheres at this level that he could have been able to get even more living bombs to have a better chance of them spreading.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's still a good build. Like, he's got a good base kit where he doesn't necessarily need, but anyway.
He doesn't actually have the... he currently, however, has as much damage as Anubarak.
Yeah, well, Anubarak has pretty good damage, so that's no shame.
Yeah, that is fair enough. But still going to have a reasonable amount of damage output. The real test is going to be whether he does Master of Flames. For now, Lingering Apparition Zickle begins to flee. Great zombie walls, but this does look familiar once again. Entombment's dropped. This time, though, Greyman cannot make it over. And Nuti is going to be safe. Zickle takes a lot of damage and barely escapes as well.
Nubarak always holding the fort down here, and he does it well, BKB. Not the first time he's 1v3 in the bottom, as there's a big rotation trying to get Nuti. This time he was too slippery. Did go for Ice Block, by the way. Could have maybe, delayed his death a bit, but if you do get caught by yourself, Ice Block never truly is a solution. No one grabbing Top Shrine.
It's a delaying of the inevitable, and they are delaying Top Shrine. Instead, looking to try and get some kills. Nice Ice Block by Mapirin, but it wasn't really a huge amount of threat. The Q had already missed. But this is going to be a shrine captured by Team Gangang.
In order to get the top, though, they have to leave the bottom lane unattended. This is not an easy Dragonite for either team. It's going to come down to a fight.
I mean, it's been going for a very long time.
Yeah.
They've had one Dragonite all game and not since. And we're at the 14-minute mark. Kael'thas dropping some damage. Able to kill off Rask here with the help of the Cursed Bullet. Down goes Malph as well. And that's exactly what they needed. They're not even going to go for the Dragonite yet, though. Instead, gain value out of the time that the enemies are dead and push in bot.
Very nicely done by Team Gangang. They found the opportunity that they've been waiting for. Starting to push in here. Level 19, going for the keep wall. Who is there to stop them? Nazebo staying top. Goes for the Hearthstone now. Leoric actually go to try and snipe the Dragon Knight away. And I think he can.
Apparition will get him to mid very quickly.
Oh,
it makes you move very fast.
If they get Valor, they can end.
Bad time for Valor. Killed off at a 54-second respawn. And Zuku's not even going to go get the deke. Oh, yes, he is. But now he's unmounted. He could have actually gone when he was mounted, but the indecision could cost him here. He's now deciding to be back and help his team. But like we said, indecision could be bad. Mafiro will be alive. He'll have Twilight Dream available. Blind is good from Johanna, delaying this core from going down. The tomb is good. Twilight Dream hit multiple heroes, but it's not enough. GG. And we will see Gangang take game number one.
GG. Very nicely played. They snowballed that advantage that they found, that opportunity, all the way to a fort kill. A keep kill and a follow-up kill on Vala, and that sealed the deal. Some indecision by Leoric, but I dare say, if he wasn't going to be there in the first place at defending the keep, I don't think either taking the DK or coming home earlier would have mattered. There was a huge margin.
Even if he brought the DK home, it wouldn't have had enough damage to really help, likely.
That was a pretty big margin there for the victory of Team Gangang once they got Vala and the keep.
Pretty rough position, pretty rough situation, but Team Gangang from 0 points to 1-0 up in the grand finals. This is a best of three, so all they have to do is to win one more, guarantee themselves a solid 120 points, and that will put them quite high in the standings. We will see. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the draft of game number two of our grand finals. Going to be on Infernal Shrines with Maw on the left hand side and Team Gangang. Currently 1-0 up on the right.
Winner will secure 70 points to solidify their good seed in the playoffs, as well as $600. Loser, $300. 40 points, is it?
I believe so. I think 40 is the minimum. I just closed it, otherwise I would tell you. But I'm not able to. Acid up. First ban. Moving back to some standards here.
Yeah. Arthur's ban, maybe.
The hackup. Also strong. Good global rotations on this map are very important.
the question is being posed if Taiwan is a bigger region than NA.
What, in terms of scale or in terms of populace? Because in terms of populace, it's NA.
I can deny that with a relative confidence that NA has more people living.
Yes. Also, if you're talking about landmass, NA is once again bigger.
Yeah, true.
Audience, I'm pretty sure, again, it's NA. I don't know.
GDP.
GDP, yeah, probably NA.
Yeah.
Military strength, NA.
Circumference of the borders, probably NA.
Yeah, NA. NA does a lot of things big.
However, in terms of HOTS performance,
probably not. Probably not NA.
For now, at least. They do have the BlizzCon victory to look back on.
EU doesn't have one. EU versus NA, confirmed. You're welcome, NA Twitch chat.
Got your back.
Got your back. We have Dahakam was the bad, Arthur's first pick, and Anubrak sneaks it in the first couple picks as well, along with Greymane.
Malfurion is still available. Ragnaros, yep. Popular pick on Infernal Shrines. I haven't seen a whole lot of Diablo today.
We haven't. We saw him once in China today, didn't work.
This is a best of three.
Coming in.
If Team Gangang wins this, they close it out. They take the victory here in the finals.
Indeed, we have two of the best heroes in terms of poke damage, Gul'dan and Greymane versus each other, with the Aurel coming in once again.
Yeah, Vala would really round out their damage types and their comp together with a final warrior potentially in the fifth slot. So that'll be a pretty smart ban by Moa.
Pretty good. Vala getting removed. Now, what will we see as a ban from Team Gangang? Support, Mouth, I would say probably remove that from Greymane. Rhaegar would work still as well, but you kind of want to remove that, the innovate potential, and of course that horrifyingly scary Twilight Dream.
Yeah, I think so too. I think Mouth is just a little bit more decisive in fights. Twilight Dream often has a greater effect than Ancestral.
Yeah. Unless it's Bloodlust, my god. Not sure about that.
Yeah.
Taking their time with it. Gonna work out. It's gonna be Sonya. Also solid ban.
Actually, Greymane and Ubrak Sonya would be pretty sick dive potential.
Yep, that would be scary as able to do some huge wiping here. Mafurin is picked up. Not a huge surprise there. Now, what are they running with it? They need another tank, probably. Nubrak's other tank would be pretty rough on them. Tyrael might be work here.
Really would like Zarya here, actually. Any target that's Crystal Aegis, you land an expulsion zone right after it, isolate them.
Yeah. Hell comes in again.
But not.
This time for more.
Yeah, not by Xay3.
Yeah. Oh, still, lovely little bit of a ability power sieging potential, which could work out for him. Now, what are we going to see from Maw? I'm sorry, Gangang, they're on that side.
Presumably, False start.
That'd be good. Any kind of auto attack hero, really, so that they have something to fill in for what Gul'dan can't do. And then probably another frontliner.
Yeah, I would think so. Could do Johanna Falstad. I don't know if I really like that enough.
Zeratul's still open. They could try something like that. Mafurin and Kael'thas could be a bit vulnerable in the back.
Yeah.
Lucio, Lunara. So they're going for the double support.
Aria,
and bringing
Lucio.
In even more poison.
I've seen that from Fnatic in the finals of the King's Cup.
Indeed. It's been around for a while in different forms. It is very effective.
I haven't seen it besides this one.
Have you
and
not?
That one? No.
I've seen it in multiple different forms in scrims and matches. It is very effective. Fnatic, basically, during the Kings of the Storm, ran it multiple times, and the only team that beat it was Expert.
Okay, so I saw it from its worst side, where they lost, but apparently they got wins with it.
No, it is good. It is very good. Usually, though, it would be run with one ranged and two frontline.
Okay.
You gain maximum value out of the speed. So, interesting to see them run it this way. And Stitches, one, two, three. That's a lot of follow-up burst and a lot of follow-up CC.
Cool.
I like it.
Very cool.
So let's count the hook targets. Four.
Everybody.
Everybody. So Lunara's almost definitely going to go Leaping Strike because, one, it's the more common heroic at this point, and two, it's her only chance of escaping Stitches.
Yeah. And I think, I think Arthas is the only one you don't want to be hooking here.
Yep, I would agree.
Had that 2 days ago in Hero League. Someone hooked Arthas into me. I was Kel'Thas with 19 out of 20 convection stacks.
Why have you done this to me?
Why did you do this?
Why have you brought this blight upon us?
Yeah.
What have you done?
Quite literally.
Yeah, exactly. But ladies and gentlemen, it is time for game number two of our grand finals. Spawning on the left-hand side of Infernal Shrines, it is going to be Team Gangang. So he's adding a little bit of shrine potential for his team as well.
I guess the only question really is, who do you put your crown on as Ario? They're both so good.
I think we're back to the competition again of whoever has the most damage shall earn the crown.
I shall be looking at the score screen.
I'm going to AFK the first 2 minutes. You guys do damage. And I'll put the after the first minute, I will start playing the game. And I'll put the crown whoever has the most by then.
Yeah. Let's see.
Compete for my love.
I didn't want to say it. I wanted to say it too. Two supports, no cleanse is an interesting thing.
Yeah, versus Stitches. Yeah. This could be good. This is similar to an issue that we did see at the Western Clash, where it was like, okay, we don't have cleanse, we're just going to pick Stitches. Stitches is bringing that comp out for us. They used it with Taranda, though. In this case, we're going to be using Mafurion as the follow-up. Good dodge by Nuti.
Nice belay.
First blood from being achieved.
God, double dampen magic against two poison damage-stealing damage dealers. That's pretty insane.
Very lovely. And then we're going to see Giant Killer later on, and everything shall be destroyed. And the hero, once again, positioning and looking for the kill, the 4-man rotation, looking for snipes, but so safely played here by Maw. Lots of poison being gained currently.
Yeah, I really wonder how Anub or Stitches could ever be killed here. I guess Lunara has to run Giant Killer, right?
Yeah, she has to. Just an auto-attack build, I would say. In order to have any chance, Adi Hero just running straight up to the tower there. Wanted to try and hook Rasm over the wall, I think, but Rasm is already out of range and out of position for hooking anyway.
Think about it. Just sit down and think about it, Tetcher.
I am sat down and I am currently thinking about it.
Okay. Good. Because I don't think you can wait till level 13 to start winning this game. I wonder if. I guess, the game will show it, but I wonder. If Gangang is just going to run away with this game.
But the strategy here for Maw should, in theory, just be kill them quick, kill the back line, ignore the front line.
Can you really ignore Stitches? I guess you can ignore Stitches until Putrid Bile.
Yeah, this is true.
Anubarak, a little bit tougher to ignore.
Or until Gorge, where Stitches becomes slightly harder to ignore because he becomes that way to that person who does not respect personal space.
Yeah, I guess he could go Gorge. You might be right. There's only one frontliner. No. Yeah,
no
cleanse. Gorge.
Oh, hook lands. Follow-up stun. Follow-up root. Follow-up stun. How much CC? And it's not enough.
Okay, so it turns out Maw is pretty hard to kill as well. We've got a match here, ladies and gents.
Double healers. Ladies and gentlemen, first blood may take a while.
We're
seeing the objective beginning. Both teams getting up there pretty quick, but currently the lead going over to Team Gangang.
point blank hook.
There is dot of the CC, and instead it's going to be Rask wading forward, attempting to get to Zay, doing exactly what we said, ignoring anti-hero, but unfortunately, anti-hero too large, able to body block anyone from chasing Zay.
Did you say too large?
Too large.
Oh, okay. I thought you were calling him
low.
Fat.
He's tanky, but is he tanky enough? Is Siku won't give in the flame strike, guarantees the kill.
Siku, full energy, must have not had cooldown available to heal Arthas. That means the objective is going to Team Gangang. Early game advantage, not surprising considering the situation. Level 13 and Lunara definitely needed to deal with this front line.
Yeah, this is a potential issue with with Ahriel early in the game. The long cooldown of her heal, which is why it's almost always the cooldown reduction taken on level 7.
Bursting Light, so good. I really undervalued that one. I thought it was for sure the weakest for such a long time.
I thought it was all about burst healing for Ahriel, but it's totally not. Siku taking a little bit of damage. He's at full energy. Going to be able to heal the team when they group up. Hook onto Rask. No follow-up stun, though, because it's Arthas, and they don't want to regret their life choices. Punisher will get killed off quite quickly, but they were able to get the front wall. And that's about as much as they could ask for. Now they're debating whether they want to trap someone. Stitches looked for a helping hand hook, but BKB did not need it. It's another living bomb! Kael'thas!
Oh!
That King's Fury!
Okay.
So, he did intend to do it.
But... Wait a second. Oh! They were switched in the draft as well.
Yeah, so it's the same. It is just a...
It is a Zay thing. Got it. Okay, so right. Definitely not a misclick now.
Yeah, we know that. We have learned.
It could be two misclicks. Okay, I'm just...
two misclicks!
No, I don't know. Okay, so Sun King Fury is a legit choice by Zay 3.
Yep. If he wins one game, if he wins two games with it, is it officially a good choice?
Yeah, well, I can't measure the progress during a cast, like how much value it does.
Nooty hooked in. No stun to follow up this time. No one was in range, so he is able to escape. Takes a decent amount of damage, though. And they have changed their rotation a bit. They've actually got a bad left noob rack up top lane to fight Arthas, and they brought Greymane down to add burst damage. Gul'dan has taken the Curse of Exhaustion, which is going to be exceptionally annoying late game.
Curse of Exhaustion. You know what? If he lands that on Stitches 5 seconds before Stitches hooks and gorges, it will slow Stitches walk away.
Well, it's pretty much a given that Stitches is probably going to go for Bile, but Gorge would be fun.
No, you know what? I think you were right when you said Gorge. I don't see... Yeah, I mean...
I said it as a joke to begin with, but I could definitely see why they would pick it.
They could hard engage with it through Lucio, Ahriel and stuff, but I just wonder if Lucio is on point, you can speed push people out on time.
Maybe.
I think it might be Gorge, but we'll see.
They pick it. They already have some follow-up CC in the form of Tenderizer and, of course, all of their stuns and roots. But we will see. Level 10 is very fast approaching for Gangang as they have a level lead. Unfortunately, they cleared bot lane first, so as such, the shrine very much in advanced, taken for Ma. BKB once again out-burrowing anti-hero.
Wow.
And he get taken out. The helping hand not able to be used there because anti-hero burrowed... BKB burrowed away from it.
Ah, wow, they get stitches as well. This is such a steal. So well done by Ma here.
And here's 10, just in time.
Yep.
It is Future Pile. Twilight Dreams, Phoenix, the Locust Swarm, and Greymane, once again, going with the Cursed Bullet to destroy Arthas.
That was so sick. Getting the Punisher and 2 kills when you were a talent down and level down. Still the case. Well, I mean, they were almost a talent down, but they were so close to it. Really well done here by Ma. And the 2 unkillables in the Anubarak stitches. I mean, Anubarak was so deep, so he was so cheeky to be 4v1 top lane, and he still almost got away.
Yeah, if he had been more... I think we're actually seeing, like you said, this team have not scrimmed together. We're starting to see for the first time slight showings of that, where anti-hero is attempting to helping hand hook BKB, and they're not able to get him because BKB burrows himself out. Also, Thornwood Vine coming in for Lunara.
Oh, okay. That's so interesting.
Yeah.
A lot of faith here. She
had one chance of escape and has decided to not take it. Interesting choice there. She has Winter Spear. There's a lot of AoE damage, to be fair.
And also not going for Wild Vigor, the auto attack damage to deal with two dampened magic warriors. It seems like we make much more of the anti-mageness of Stitches and a Noob than these pro players here. So we might just be making too much of it. They're not going to, you know, change everything.
Maybe. That's it. We'll see. Currently, there have been 3 kills in this game, and 2 of them were, in fact, those anti-mages. And Hero, once again, not able to land the hook. Nice play by Ma, able to dance around this. They play top board is very low because currently, even though they are currently a kill behind, they are still Gangang still ahead in levels and are currently a fort ahead and about to be 2 forts ahead. And Hero drops his vial straight away. The Horrify is used to try and escape. BKB is staying alive for the moment thanks to that Locust Swarm. Hook was good and down goes iHeart. Whoa, nicely done there. And Raid Boss, even thanks to the Table Strike, is not going down. Anti-Hero is poisoned. Where's the heal? Mouth, get in there. There we go. Healing and the Fountain will be able to keep him alive. And they're able to turn around a bit. But it is Arthas they're turning around on who's tanking through. Never mind. Back in he comes. And he might drop here. Heal. Heal.
Yep. Lips. It's that bursting light. Ariel saves from Esmei. Well done. Funny curse of exhaustion on the Nubarak and Stitches there, which affected them just as they were about to go for Arthas' hook. But he got in range just at the edge of it. Great hooks there. But Anti-Hero, and now one takedown extra here for Team Gangang. And they're going to be first on the shrine. Not that much faster.
Yeah, still in a reasonable position. Rask wades his way in to do damage to Anti-Hero. As Anti-Hero looks for a delicious signal to maybe grab with his hook.
Oh, yes. Close. And they believed him. Gravity Lapse and Entangle.
I mean, if you hadn't believed him and Zikul got away because you were late from your CC, you would be mad. Instead, they are able to escape. That extra movement speed they're getting from the Bile is actually really useful for getting away from that Curse of Exhaustion.
Yeah, and from Arthas. Definitely a good choice there.
They got him this time. The Aegis is used, though. And Nuti in full retreat. Raid Boss coming in, but the bursting light. Zik with the heal, keeping Nuti alive. And Raid Boss is now being bullied by Rask. manages to Razor Swipe into an Arthas root. And BKB not able to land the stun there.
Talent lead for Gangang. Anti-Hero's dropping low. He's getting lashed there. Stun Twilight Dream Arthas.
He's tanking through Anti-Hero. Oh, no health. Hooks in Arthas and is able to get the kill, healing himself back up with his E and amplified healing that he took at level 4. Nicely done.
Ready for Curse of Exhaustion and Q. Such a relevant talent. Well, it doesn't always get value, but it can be really good.
Yeah, it's always a situation of it happens where if you win the fight, then it's great because it means people who are running away get slowed and you're able to guarantee them as kills as well. If you lose the fight, then it just feels bad where the enemy has already killed you and then they're slow.
Yeah, very well said. I think that's definitely also the case.
Yeah. No giant killer.
No.
Holudara sticking with the unfair advantage. More poison coming in, doing as much damage as possible. Once again, hook is dodged. Stitches with Fleabag this time. If he's stunned or rooted, he can get that 6-second cooldown reduction, which is great for hooks.
So does that mean Arthas does not get Remorseless Winter at 16? Frostmourne
Feeds?
Don't.
I think it's a really good reason to not do that.
Frostmourne Feeds. Auto attack damage, we need it. He should have gone full Frostmourne build. Misplay. No, just kidding. It's funny, but ultimately very risky.
Yeah, and Hero wading in. The knock-up on iHop Woke could have been an opening. Punisher is taken here. They hook him in. There is the Aegis once again. And the Horrify grabbing everyone. Icebolt keeps Kronos alive. He drops a Twilight Dream, though, but still gets taken out. The Punisher, though, is a blue team Punisher and is cleaning up. It is currently a 1-for-1. Good detainment strike by Zikku to try and escape. BKB will have Burrow soon, though, to try and engage on this. Punisher stuns onto iHop. Whoa, the fort dies. It had only 600 health. And we are seeing Gangang continuing to push through this.
You know what I suddenly realized, and much belatedly, I'm sure half the chat already knew, Curse of Exhaustion is of course going to empower Unfair Advantage. And at the time where it's most relevant, Arthas does the first bit. 10-second poison is the cap of Lunara, that's her trait, up to 10 seconds of poison damage. Arthas does the first, and Gul'dan does the last. Actually, really cool. Because I was wondering, why was there so much poison damage on everyone? It's like, yeah, it's corruption and poison, but it's just about the most poison you can put on heroes.
Yeah, didn't even think about it. Well played. Nicely thought out there. And we're going to see Team Gangang though continuing their lead. Even with all of that poison damage, they're going to be able to take down the last remaining fort. And instead, they're going to move on and start taking mercenaries to begin putting pressure on so that they can later, with objectives or with one team fights, begin putting pressure onto the keeps.
Yeah. And it's down to the three keeps here for MAA. They lost their outer perimeter, the three forts. Power spike for Lunara is not really tied to a specific talent. But few people know. You can't really find this anywhere. You need to have played heroes for a while. Lunara has a greater than normal poison damage scaling per level. She gains, is it 4.5% or 5% extra damage?
I am not sure.
Per level. But that's more than the usual of 4%. And so Lunara is known as a late game hero because of this.
So a new... was attempting a fishing hook there, but not able to get there. BBB, by the way, has debilitation to try and dive even more efficiently onto the heroes like that.
Remove some of the support as well.
It does. Could work out very well in their favor. Fury of the Sunwell was once again taken. Hooks in. It is Arthas, but he's dropping down. They're dropping him... The Aegis keeps him alive. Horrify once again. And Nuti has been the savior of his team so many times. Ariel, no Aegis for you. You are dead. And the follow-up, Handy Hero, able to get it.
I mean, that was always going to be like a big win for Team Gangang. Every heroic was used to save Arthas. So any second they stay there is like tempting fate. Next hook could kill someone. So the only reasonable thing to do would be to not be there or be mounted. And they really wanted to defend that keep. They could not accept that. So nice kill there on Ariel. But, you know, not the end of the world for MAA. They're still level 16 talents. Heroics are back sooner, though, for Team Gangang. It's looking really good for Gangang. They just need
they
to
are looking in a
do
solid
a few more good
here.
Moves.
Going to be able to begin taking down this objective. Going to be able to get themselves that Arcane Punisher and begin to put pressure onto the bot keep. BKB taking a little bit of poke damage, able to get some stuns, gets Lucio, root, stun, gone!
Yeah. Nice synergy.
Couldn't even Aegis. Sicko couldn't even get in range to Aegis in time.
Lucio couldn't even do nothing.
No, he was in the sky and then in the ground. He did not have a huge amount of time to react there. We're seeing Stitches looking for an opportunity to grab another, just missing Gul'dan there. This is looking great for Gangang here. Anti-hero moving in, looking for his opportunity. Hook will be up soon. He's looking for his target.
Can he find it? Anti-hero's been playing great today. Heroes like Chen, Yorick, now Stitches, goes with the hook, and he gets Gul'dan!
The Aegis is good this time. If Gul'dan can horrify, nope, the stun is good. And Gul'dan gets taken out. That was very much a split second of who would hit their button first. Zikku, in full retreat, gets a good break it down at a sound barrier, keeping Zikku alive for the moment,
Raid
and
boss.
As such, the poison is starting to take effect! Raid boss dropping down, finally finished off. Zay chucks in the Phoenix. It is 4-4, nicely done, and that may save MAA the game, at least temporarily.
Very much so. They may even take only a few percentages of core damage.
Sentinel's really good. The fucking Sentinel's a lot of damage being dropped here. And they are finally able to finish off the Punisher, but they're spending so much time dodging these things, because look at that, Zeus taking so much damage. Minions preventing the shield from recharging too. Finally, they're going to be able to have that shield recharge, but it's 67% core now.
Whew. Okay.
Ooh, indeed.
I don't know if Gangang could have finished the core if they went for it instead of the three-man dive to the north of the core to get a kill. You could say that that kill could have represented MAA dissuasive damage on them, like if they didn't get the kill with the hero being alive, but it's hard to say. 67% is a pretty big gap, and so I think they're happy with the damage that they've done.
Yeah, and they lost hook attempted onto Arthas there, not able to get it. Yeah, with the loss of Greymane as well, if he'd stayed alive, they may have had the core damage, because Greymane has the most single target damage in terms of bursting down cores.
But look at this, so much pressure already.
Yeah, the Impaler's perfectly timed, putting it on some pressure down there.
I half feel like Gangang should be going for Enemy Bruiser now, since they know this must be responded to, so they can afford to be greedy and then safe. Even if they get into a fight, they lose. That will be more core damage still. So I feel like it's a little bit too safe.
I kind of like what they're doing. They can see that there are only a couple people here, so that they know that if they move to the Bruiser quick enough and engage it, there's a chance the enemy will be doing it so they can catch someone. Instead, they find Rask in the lane. They're going to try and burst him down instead, and they manage it.
So the cool thing about that is, since they land the debilitating charge on Arthas, his self-coil is going to do less healing. Army of the Dead, if it came up. But there was too much CC follow-up anyway. Great synergy. Just one impale miss. Oh, wow!
The vault
that was so cool.
Stitches. Oh, clap, the Aegis is dropped, but it's not going to be enough. They keep Nuti CC. No Horrify is available. Down goes Iku. Vault Kronas as well. Just a body block. My Dream had already been used there. And there's the hook on Nuti too. BKB is so poisoned,
beautiful.
But it doesn't matter. Full team wipe. By Gangang there, they get the keep, and they're gonna get the core. Well played. That's gonna be the series and the grand finals.
So well played here. Super cool. 2-0 Team Gangang. No scrims as a full team, but they've done it. 2-0 and they win Cup 6 of the HGC Europe Open Division. Very well done.
From 0 points to winning Cup number 6, which I believe secures them into a... That secures them 5th place above Well Played Me.
Not half bad. And they've got one more cup to improve upon their score. As the better your seed is, the more likely you are to have a quote-unquote easier way to the finals of the final playoffs, where the top 2 will be triumphant.
What does that mean? Baseline junkie? Someone who likes the bottom line of the story, or what? We should capture this mercenary. I'll go for party mix. That's my jam. Ooh, jackpot! Jackpot! Get back! I am renewed. Listen up. This is gonna make you feel better.